Good morning. As some of you know, I am Edward Pritchard. I'm an elder here at First Presbyterian. I welcome everyone that is here in person and everyone watching online. Reverend Neil Mathers will be conducting the service today. Jacqueline, Deb, and myself, and Connor are on the praise band, and we have Catherine Brown helping with the piano, and Cindy Lewis on the organ. And we couldn't do any of that without Jonathan on the sound and Yancey on the slides and Denman on the cameras. If you're interested in the upcoming Alpha program, it is going to be conducted on Zoom. And if you would like to know more about it, take a look at the poster in the Welcome Center or look at the video on the Thursday MailChimp mailout. After the service, if you go down to the lower hall, we have coffee made by Sherry Robinson and family, with baked goods by Marie Ewing. Helpers are needed on a regular basis to make coffee and cookies, so if you can help, please let Marlene know in the office. Next Sunday, September the 25th, our guest speaker is Erin White, who is the director of Collingwood Youth for Christ. Our time to talk is happening once again this Thursday morning at 10 a.m. on the Beach Street Garden property. You can bring your lawn chair and a coffee or tea, but then also again at 7:30 p.m. inside in the lower hall. Let's pray. Beautiful, loving God, we thank you for this opportunity to gather together to worship. May our worship today and all that we do every day be pleasing to you. We thank you for all the good in our lives, for our families, our friends, and for this church family. We thank you also for helping us through difficult times and helping us to grow through our challenges so that we might grow ever closer to our true selves and towards you. Fill us, O God, with your life-giving spirit, that we would follow your ways, grow ever closer to you, live in your love, and share your love with others. We pray together the ancient words passed down from Jesus. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Children and youth here, they're very much welcome to come up right now. Anyone? Connor? No? Fine. So then I will ask the congregation. I have a question. Does anybody here like to garden? Any gardening fans? Okay. I don't like gardening. I don't like dirt very much. So, can anyone answer me, what do I need to grow, there's my mic, an apple tree? Shout it out. Seed? Water? Sunshine? Dirt? Yeah. Love? So, just like growing an apple tree, it's somewhat like us as Christians. The Bible talks about how God wants us to grow and bear fruit. But I don't think we're like an apple tree very much. We are like the fruits of the Spirit. Now, does anyone know what the fruits of the Spirit are? There's nine of them. Pages, kindness. Now, there's a little song that goes along with it, and there's some actions, and I have a hand mic, so I can't really do them. So there's love. So you put your hands across. You follow me. This down. Love. There's joy. Peace. Patience. Kindness. Goodness. Faithfulness. Gentleness. And self-control. So, the key thing to remember is that the key thing to remember is that fruit comes from when we are planted in the Lord. And how do we plant ourselves in the Lord? There's a few things we can do. We can pray. We can read the Bible. We can go to church on Sundays. And all these things can help us grow and bear the fruits of the Spirit. So, let us pray and repeat after me. Dear God, thank you for this day. Thank you for the gifts of your Spirit. Help us to grow in love, joy, peace, and patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. Do you want to say to Jessica that I know from personal experience the hardest thing to do is to tell a children's story when there are no children in church. except Jesus said to us, unless you turn and become like little children, you cannot enter the kingdom of God. So the children were all here, Jessica. Our first scripture is Psalm 16, reading verses 1 to 11, a passage about keeping me safe. Keep me safe, O God, for I have come to you for refuge. I said to the Lord, you are my master. Every good thing I have comes from you. The godly people in the land are my true heroes. I take pleasure in them. Troubles multiply for those who chase after other gods. I will not take part in their sacrifices of blood or even speak the names of their gods. Lord, you alone are my inheritance, my cup of blessing. You guard all that is mine. The land you have given me is a pleasant land. What a wonderful inheritance. I will bless the Lord who guides me. Even at night, my heart instructs me. I know the Lord is always with me. I will not be shaken, for he is right beside me. No wonder my heart is glad and I rejoice. My body rests in safety. For you will not leave my soul among the dead or allow your Holy One to rot in the grave. You will show me the way of life, granting me the joy of your presence and the pleasures of living with you forever. Our second reading is the words of Jesus from John chapter 10, verses 1 to 11. And again, it's on the theme of us being kept safe. I tell you the truth. Anyone who sneaks over the wall of a sheepfold rather than going through the gate must surely be a thief and robber. But the one who enters through the gate is the shepherd of the sheep. The gatekeeper opens a gate for him, and the sheep recognize his voice and come to him. He calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. After he has gathered his own flock, he walks ahead of them, and they follow him because they know his voice. They won't follow a stranger. They'll run from him because they don't know his voice. Those who heard Jesus use this illustration didn't understand what he meant, so he explained it to them. I tell you the truth, I am the gate for the sheep. All who came before me were thieves and robbers, but the true sheep did not listen to them. Yes, I am the gate. Those who come in through me will be saved. They will come and go freely and will find good pastures. The thief's purpose is to steal and kill and destroy. My purpose is to give them a rich and a satisfying life. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd sacrifices his life for the sheep. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Ask sometimes why I bring up my music when Yancy does such a great job with with the words and that, and it's kind of like a love letter from my mom is how I see it. So she writes little notes to me on my music all the time, and she always does my music. So if you ever wonder, that's why, it's just to see my mom.
Trying to feel that same old hole inside. Well, there's a better life. There's a better life. If you got pain, he's a pain taker. If you feel lost, he's a way. Chain breaker. day in the dead of night. We've all found ourselves worn out from the same old fight. We've all run to things we know just ain't right. When there's a better life, there's a better life. We got pain, he's a pain taker. If you feel lost, he's a way maker. If you need freedom, saving, he's a prison shaking savior. If you got chains, he's a chain breaker. You believe it, you can receive it, then you will feel it once you recognize. If you believe it, you can receive it, then you will feel it once you recognize.
Thank you. I actually have notes on my script as well. I really do it to confuse the IT team. But after you've written a message, as you think about it over that week, God kind of gives you other things. So I've got notes from my Heavenly Father on my script. And you kind of add them in, but you forget to tell the tech team. So they're looking at their scripts going, Where did that come from? Thank you very much. That was a great solo. Let's bow in prayer. Dear God, speak to us. As you've spoken to your people down through many centuries, become real for us as you have been real for them. And as we hear your word, help us to respond to it. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, over the last 5 weeks, we've been talking about where faith intersects with life, or where life intersects with faith. You can check out the other messages on the church website. Today, we're going to end this series with a question that I think all of us have asked at some time in our lives. I know I've asked it at points in my life. Pretty certain there are times that you've asked the same question. And it's this one. Is God really for us? Is God really for us? When life isn't easy, when it drags us down to the depths, when a situation is bad and only gets worse, when a loved one dies, when a significant relationship breaks up, when a friend stabs us in the back, when a spouse betrays us, when our children really disappoint us, when we make bad choices that lead us down the wrong path, when life doesn't turn out the way we think it should, when our hopes and dreams are frustrated, when there seems to be no answer to our most earnest prayers, we wonder, is God really for us? Now, let me stop there for a moment and say this, because it's so important. Only people of faith ask that question. Only people of faith are willing to express their doubts in such an honest way. See, living with doubt is actually part of our Christian experience. Let me quote from a section of Living Faith, which is one of the subordinate standards of the Presbyterian Church in Canada. This is from the section on doubt. We are not always certain that God is with us. At times, God calls us to live in this world without experiencing the divine presence, often discerning God's nearness only as we look back. At other times, God seems absent in order that our faith may be tested. Through such struggle, we mature in faith. God may also chastise and strengthen us through the hard circumstances of life. So, when we hear that question in our minds, is God really for us? Let's be bold enough to see that as part of the journey of faith. Listen to how Scripture answers that question in Romans 8, verse 31 and verse 39. If God is for us, who will be against us? Nothing in all creation will ever be able to separate us from the love of God, which is ours through Christ Jesus, our Lord. Is God really for us? Do you want proof? Scripture says, look at the cross. The cross where Jesus suffered and died that our sins might be forgiven. The cross where we are reconciled to God. And look at the empty tomb. Jesus is alive and he offers new life to us. Here's the promise declared in 2 Corinthians 5:17. When anyone is joined to Christ, he is a new being. The old is gone, the new has come. The proof that God is for us is written across the record of Scripture and in the lives and in the witnesses of God's people throughout history. This God who is with us is the God of new beginnings and fresh starts. There's lots of evidence in the Bible for that. To his people exiled in Babylon because of their sin, God offers hope through the prophet Jeremiah. God says, I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future. To the woman caught in adultery, who people wanted to stone to death, but whom no one would condemn when Jesus confronted them with their own sin, Jesus said, then neither do I condemn you. Go now and leave your life of sin. To Zacchaeus, the tax collector, who repented of his thieving ways and came to faith in Jesus, Jesus said in Luke 19, verse 9, today salvation has come to this house. To the thief hanging from the cross and who asked Jesus to remember him when he came into his kingdom, Jesus said, today you will be with me in paradise. There's the evidence. God is for us, not against us. He's for us even when we think he's not. He's for us when we mess up. He's for us when trouble and tragedy afflict us. He's for us when life doesn't turn out the way we expect or the way we hoped for. He's for us when we hit rock bottom. He's for us because he has a purpose for our life, expressed by Jesus in that passage we read from John's Gospel in John 10, verse 10, where he said, I have come that you may have life and have it to the full. You see, God doesn't want us to live our lives down in the dumps. He doesn't want us to live our lives under the circumstances. I asked somebody not too long ago, how are you doing? I'm doing okay under the circumstances. To which I asked them, well, what are you doing under there? God doesn't want us to live our lives under the circumstances or defeated by temptation. He doesn't want us to walk around in darkness or to be buried by guilt and shame or to be separated from his love forever. He wants us to have life and to have it in full measure. He wants us to have life in the middle of our own brokenness and in the midst of the brokenness of the world. He wants us to live in the certainty of that promise we read earlier from Romans, which I'm going to just give you in a different translation, that absolutely nothing can get between us and God's love because of the way that Jesus, our Master, has embraced us. Absolutely nothing can get between us and God's love because of the way that Jesus, our Master, has embraced us. And he wants us to live in the certainty of Joshua chapter 1, verse 5, which is repeated several times in the Bible, where God says to us, I will never leave you or forsake you. I will never leave you or forsake you. Now, you all know that that's true. You all know that none of our lives have been any easier than the lives of the people we work with, the people we live next to, the people we see in the shopping mall. We've all experienced hurts and trouble and tragedy and struggles. And some of those things have brought us to our knees and left us wondering whether we could go on. But what marks us as different from other people is that we still believe God's promises. And those promises have got us through whatever we faced in life. Yes, maybe a little bit more battered, maybe a lot more bruised, maybe still with aching and broken hearts, but God's promises have got us through. And because our confidence is in a loving God, we understand that sometimes the storms that God lets into our lives have been to train us for righteousness, not to punish us. Now, there are Christians out there who honestly believe that if you trust God completely and you do His will, you'll never have any problems in life. But if that was true, how do you explain Jesus' life? Because He was slandered, ridiculed, betrayed, denied, and ultimately killed because of His faith. You see, it's what God does with us through our brokenness that's most important. 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 10. And the God of grace, who called you to His eternal glory in Christ, after you have suffered a little while, will Himself restore you and make you strong, firm, and steadfast. Why? Because God is for us, not against us. Always. As Roger Babston reminded us, when we're flat on our backs, there's only one way to look, and that's up. And as we look up, what do we see? We see through the eyes of faith that we are eternally safe in the loving arms of Jesus, that God is for us and not against us. God is for us and not against us. God can take not only the good, positive things that happen to us in life, but the terrible, tragic things as well, and He can help us to grow through them in such a way that ultimately we are not broken by them. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 13 teaches us that, and I know lots of people would attest to the truth that it teaches. 1 Corinthians 10, 13, that no test or temptation that comes your way is beyond the course of what others have had to face. All you need to remember is that God will never let you down. He'll never let you be pushed past your limits. He'll always be there to help you come through it. Read the subtext. God is for us, not against us. The Apostle Paul wrote something about life that I've always found helpful. It's probably one of the Bible verses that I treasure the most. 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verses 12 and 13. And this is from the modern phrasing of the Message translation. We don't yet see things clearly. We're squinting in a fog, peering through a mist. But it won't be long before the weather clears and the sun shines bright. We'll see it all then, see it all as clearly as God sees us, knowing Him directly just as He knows us. Now, isn't that true? That life is a mystery. Just as much as faith is often a mystery. But one day God promises us that we will understand what happens to us in this life and how it fits into God's good plan for us. But Paul hasn't finished that thought yet. He continues, but for right now, until that completeness, we have three things to do to lead us towards that. Trust steadily in God. Hope unswervingly. Love extravagantly. And the best of the three is love. Trust, hope, and love. In what? In the absolute confidence that whatever happens to us in life, God is for us, not against us. Amen? Amen. I have two pastoral announcements this morning. The first is to note the death of one of our members, Betty Hawkins. Betty's funeral is going to be on Friday, September the 30th, the last Friday of the month, at 11 a.m. here at First Church. Also like to pass on the death of one of our former members, the Reverend Dr. Alex McCombie, who died yesterday. Let us bow in prayer. O God, our help in ages past, our hope for years to come, our shelter from the stormy blast, and our eternal home. Hear us as we thank you for all of your actions and promises that remind us that we are precious to you. Thank you for assuring us that nothing can separate us from your love. Thank you for promising never to leave us or to forsake us. Thank you, Lord Jesus, that because of you, when we are hard pressed on every side, we are not crushed. When we are perplexed, we do not despair. When we are persecuted, we are not abandoned. And when we are struck down, we are not destroyed. We pray this day, mighty God, that as your Spirit moves all over the world, that the weak in spirit would be made strong, the defeated in heart would become victorious, the emotionally wounded would be healed, and that the prayers that arise from the poor, the oppressed, and the war-weary would be answered. Above all, we ask that your people everywhere would know that you are for them and not against them. So help us to trust steadily, to hope unswervingly, and to love extravagantly through Jesus Christ our Lord, in whose name we pray, and all of God's people said together, Amen. I'd like to invite Marnie Hillier and Maggie Sears to join me on the platform. Yeah, we thought it might surprise you.
She just whispered, I'm sorry for this.
Good morning. Maggie and I came to this church about, oh gosh, I think almost 10 years ago now. And we came from a church in Creemore where we live. We don't live in the church, but we live in Creemore, both of us. Those of you who are familiar with this young gal know that she radiates sunshine wherever she goes. She exudes happiness, joy. Everything about her is upbeat and optimistic. With her larger than light personality, she has honored this church, this congregation, in so many ways, with vacation Bible camp, doing the crafts, the choir, Christmas story, a little night music, pastoral care, and of course, her golden, rich voice in the special music that she honors us with. Her move to Edmonton will take her closer to her family, but a lot farther from this church family. We sure will miss her. We wish her only the best. We'll pray for her. We will know that she will be larger than life in Edmonton. And on a personal note, our friendship. Our friendship will sustain the miles, but there sure will be a hole in my heart when she goes. Love you.
Have to say something? I have to say something. I feel like I'm a new Christian, but I've come to this church, and from the minute I walked in, I came to the Christmas tree thing, and I loved it. And I feel like you have all embraced me with open arms. I feel so comfortable. I love this place. and I keep looking for a church in Alberta. I can't find one like this. Oh, this is like so wimpy. I just want to thank you all for your friendship, your fellowship, in the name of God, in the name of friendship, in the name of everything. And I am so grateful. And I will miss everyone so much. It's been a gift to me. You'll just never believe it, but it is. So thank you.
Oh, yeah, sure. Right.
It's probably something I don't know.
Oh, you'll know it.
Did you pick it?
Now, go in peace. Blessings on your journey. And may the God of grace and love and peace and the fellowship of Jesus Christ, our Savior, and the presence of the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you now and forever. Amen.